are going through by the residue method. We have already completed long division as well as we have completed the partial fraction method. Both the method we have completed. Now we have come to the third method, which is known as residue method. Let us suppose we have been supplied with one particular transfer function which are having z minus a in the numerator and denominator is given as like this. Sorry, let it be just like this. This is B, this is C, this is this kind of treatment, BC. Like this. So for this, how we will solve to get, how we will do the inverse Z transform to get x of n? If nothing is given over there, that means it's a causal one. Whenever it's a causal one, it should be always greater than 1 for causal. That means the region of convergence, it will not include z equal to 1, that pole, but it will be beyond that of z equal to 1. Now coming to this, first do the factorization. X of z equal to z minus a divided by z minus b into z minus c. Clear? So it is like this. You are getting this thing? Okay. So now we have done like this, that in the numerator we are having 1, 0, this root is z equal to a. In the denominator we are having two roots, we have two poles, b and c. Clear? What it is telling this, as first of all we are finding the order. Just see what is the highest power of z in the denominator, it is 1. So order m, that is m equal to 1. How to find the residue? As per the formula, 1 divided by 1 minus 1, that means factorial 0, that is nothing but 1. Limit z tends to infinity. So sorry, not infinity, it will be alpha. As because these are the poles, so here we can write it as alpha 1 comma alpha 2 b and c. So like that, first of all let us do it for alpha equal to a. So alpha 1, alpha 2, they are having two values b and c. So first of all we have to do this residue method for b. Now just see over here how we can solve this. D to the power n minus 1, m is 1, so 0. D to the power z m minus 1, this is also 0. Clear? Z, x of z. Into z to the power m minus 1. M is 1. So z to the power 0, that is 1. So by doing this factorization, we can come to the conclusion that how to find the residue method. Now suppose from this residue method, from alpha 1 and alpha 2, we will get two different values of z. So we are getting x1 of z and x2 of z. So finally xz will be x1 of z, that means from xz we will find the, whenever we will do the inverse z transform, we will find the x of n, and x of n will be equal to, as there are two values of alpha, that means b and c, we will get it as x1 of n plus x2 of n u of n. Because why u of n? Because this is the causal one. If we will do it for non-causal, then x of n will be equal to x1 of n plus x2 of n plus into u of minus n minus 1. Because all the causal we are knowing, it will be like this. It will be coming like this, and non-causal will be going in this side. So this is the last method, which is known as residue method for inverse Z transform. Now let us go to linear time invariant. LTI. Whenever we are writing like this, this is known as linear time invariant. How to solve this thing, linear time invariant? Suppose x1 of n is one function input. In between there will be DSP system, and y1 of n is the output. That means what we can write, that y of n is function of x of n. Clear? Now suppose if this will be shifted by plus minus k, then function of this thing will be y of plus minus k. Clear? So this is the DSP system. Actually, we can take this thing by taking impulse, step, ramp, and pulse. The fourth thing. For impulse, we are knowing this is also known as delta function. For step, we are knowing this is the notation. For ramp, this is the notation. And for pulse, this is the notation. These are the four notations. Now we are knowing the value of delta n, that is equal to 1 at n equal to 0, that is equal to 0 otherwise. So whenever we are just plotting the delta function, this value will be like this. This is indicating the delta function. Suppose if this delta function will be shifted towards here, in this location, so it will be n equal to 1. Then this value is delta of n minus 1. That means whenever we are applying impulse response, of course in the output we are getting the same change as well as there in the input. So for this thing, impulse response is termed as function of x of n, where x of n equal to delta n. Clear? Now, we will see what is LTIC, linear time invariant causal. It means linear time invariant causal. For this, if this is the input, then this will be the output. It is the exponentially decaying function coming towards n equal to 0. So we can say this thing, that we can get the convolution sum, as we have seen before, for linear time invariant causal. Similarly, we can get this change for step response also. That means for step response also, if there will be any shifted in the input, similarly there will be change in the output. Clear? Now let us come to one particular problem. Just to find out, we are knowing, we have done this thing before also, just to find out whether a function is linear or not, we have to use principle of superposition. And what that principle of superposition is telling, if x1 of n and x2 of n are two functions, then they should hold this property. Should hold this property. Is it clear? Now suppose, let us just try with one problem. Suppose it is given like this, e to the power xn. This is one term. Just see whether this is linear or not. As x of n equal to this, hence x1 of n will be this, and x2 of n will be this thing. No, so now when I will write function of x1 of n plus x2 of n, what it will be like this, it will be like e to the power x1 of n plus x2 of n. Now it can be written as e to the power, as per the laws of indices, like this. But if I will do it separately, say separately, and then if I will add them, this will be like this. These two are not similar. So this function is a non-linear function. Similarly, suppose this one is given to us, d2y dt square plus 5 dt plus 6y of t equal to x of t. How we can solve this thing? First, find it for x1 and y1. So it will be for x1, y1 pair, it will be like this. And for x2y2 pair it will be like this. What we have to do first? We have to add them separately, and after that we have to add them conjugately. That means we have to do it like this: d2 y1 of t plus y2 of t dt square plus 5 d y1 of t plus y2 of t dt plus 6 y1 of t plus y2 of t equal to x1 of t plus x2 of t as a whole for function. And if we will do it separately, then add them, add both of them, and after that check whether the principle of superposition is holding for this or not. And of course in this case the principle of superposition will be holding. That means this is one linear function. As per linearity is concerned, there is also one more factor which is known as time invariance or time variance. That means if the input will be changing, suppose if the input will be changing by some amount, similarly there will be change in the output. It can be done like this. Clear? So, but if there will be, that will be, that means the input will be varying, the output will be varying also. What is actually time invariant? The function where the value is constant with respect to time. What is time variant? The function where the value is changing with respect to time. So first property and second property we completed. First is linearity, following principle of superposition. Second one is time variance. Let's come to the third property. That is known as causality. What is a causal signal? A signal in which the output is depending on the past value of the input. That is a causal signal. Now suppose if I am writing like this, x of n minus k, this k may be any value. Suppose k is not equal to 0, k equal to any value 1, 2, n minus 1, any value, or say m. Now just see, all of them are representing, whenever we are putting some integer over here, all of them are representing some previous values. And if the output will be depending on those previous values, then that particular function is known as a causal function. What is a non-causal or anti-causal? Which is depending on the future values of it. Suppose if I will write it like this, x of n plus 2. That means, if I will draw this thing, this is xn, this is n equal to 0, n equal to 1, n equal to 2. That means this particular point it is indicating. So instead of taking into account this thing, now you are taking this thing. That means we are taking the future values. But if I will write it like x of n minus 3, so this is minus 1, this is minus 2, this is minus 3. That means this one. Clear? Number 4. there is one more thing which is known as BIBO stability, bounded input, bounded output stability. It means bounded input, bounded output stability. We have also mentioned this thing before, that for a stable function, if it is in the form of transfer function, there should not be any poles on the left hand side of this imaginary axis. If we will consider this as S, then there should not be any pole that will be lying on the right hand side. An entire will be placed on the left hand side. If there will be any repetition on the imaginary axis for the poles, then that will be marginally stable. All these things we have discussed before. Again, these things are coming for linear time invariant method. So in this way, we can consider and we can do numerous problems based on linearity, which is based on principle of superposition, time variance, causality, and bounded input, bounded output stability for one linear time invariant system. Linear time invariant system, it is very important in nature, as because from this we will get several sample output by culturing or by inculcating their characteristics, we come to know about the nature of the signal in the output. Thank you.